that your way up to that. Really kind of, it's kind of nice to look at simple objects and reproduce them. Because you can have it right in front of you, you can turn it around and see it from different angles.
Right.
That memory takes time. ZBrush works off of memory. The more memory you have on your computer, the better. Unfortunately, my laptop only has 12 gigs. I ordered, actually, Thursday, I saw on Amazon that someone was selling some memory for, they were selling it for a nice price, and they said, oh, it'll get here by Saturday. And then Saturday came and said, oh, you won't get it until Wednesday. So I was like, dang it. So I spent money on something I don't even have yet. But the more memory you have, the easier it is for the program to work, because it's based off of your RAM, not your hard drive, just your RAM. A lot like Photoshop, if you guys are familiar with Photoshop. Anybody? Nobody? You guys know that? No? That's fine.
So you can start from very simple and then go into very detailed details.
Yeah. Steven said, you asked a question about how much the program costs.
Yeah.
There's the full version. There's actually three versions. There's the education version, which is, I think, like $400. There's the full version, which is like around $800, like $799 or something like that. And then there's another version that you can use for making money off of, which is like the professional version, but it doesn't have all the bells and whistles. And it's called ZBrush Core, and it's only like $149. As far as the sculpting stuff that I have here, you can do everything that you see me doing right now. The only thing is it doesn't have a lot of the plugins like my version has. But I would say if anybody's interested in working with ZBrush, get it as soon as possible, because the price is just gonna go up. And the upgrade is free for life. So once you buy it, you don't have to worry about buying the upgrade. Just continue to get it on and on and on forever and ever. I bought this maybe 2007 for $199. So I didn't have to pay the $800 price that everybody is paying for now. I feel in another 5 or 6 years, they're gonna start introducing more of, I can't talk. I think in the next few years they're going to add more animation tools, and the price is just going to go up higher and higher and higher. So if you're interested in this stuff, go ahead and grab it. If not, don't buy ZBrush, buy something like Mudbox that you can rent from Autodesk for free, and see if you like that first. So
you can also try Sculptress.
The technology that's based off of what I'm doing here actually came from Sculptress. And ZBrush bought them, or Pixelogic bought them out to add it into the program. And then the guy who made Sculptress actually works for Pixelogic now. So this same stuff that I'm doing, you get it for free for Sculptress. You just don't have all the bells and whistles and the pretty interface that you have here. So, all right, so it's been another 15 minutes. I'm gonna jump another 4 hours into this, show you guys what it's gonna look like. So we have more of a detailed model. Way how I'm doing the back portion here is I'm taking my clay sculpt and I'm still building this up. It's increased my intensity. Now sometimes you'll get those strips, but that's only because I'm using only ZBrush. If I had a Maya model, you still get those strips, but you just have to be careful as far as building this out.
Any other questions? That's my part of this, is just to say, any other questions?
You sit here?
Right.
Oh, ask me some questions. His name is Makia. Say Makia. Why do you make Rodney teach character modeling?
Because they're the best.
See, now I have to buy him lunch or something.
Nice.
Just don't let him pick the place. It's the inside joke.
Inside joke. Yeah.
Curious, how long did it take you to get
One day.
One
day. Quick, though, you know.
What do you mean, as far as learning this, the software, or?
Well, just to get, you know, exposure is looking like.
To get proficient at it.
Proficient, yeah.
You know what? When I started working with ZBrush, and we were in a galaxy by the name Scott Spencer.
Yeah.
He actually turned, I mean, I knew about it before he actually told me he was using it. We went to school together, and he worked on a project with me in school. And he said, hey man, you should seriously look at ZBrush for doing your character and preaching. And I said, well, I've looked into it, I just don't want to do it. And he started showing me stuff, and I said, well, yeah, but how's that going to be used in the real world? And he started explaining this stuff to me. And I'm sitting there saying, okay, well, I'll give it a shot. And the first model that I built and that I actually paid attention to, I actually tried, was in 2005. And Scott looked at it and he said, maybe you shouldn't do this anymore.
didn't listen to him, did you?
No, not really. I don't know, maybe I should have. My background is mostly that. To be honest, it's composite. I don't know if you know what that is. Composite is where you take 3D, you guys watch Jurassic Park, any of them? All right, they have a CG dinosaur, right? You take that CG dinosaur, you take the real environment, you put it together, make it like it belongs there. That's composite. That's what I was trained in. My first job was modeling. because, I don't know, I don't think I was good as a compositor, so I never got a job like that. My first job was actually teaching people how to use the software for compositing. There's a studio in Chicago, and the guy who was working there actually told me that I should start teaching at a school, and that's how I started teaching at a university or a college level. Then I got stuck in the 3D model.
Stuck. Like, stuck.
Well, I had my ideas of doing other things, but it happened.
Right.
First bump's free.
What's that?
I said first bump's free.
All right, so I'm going to change brushes. I've been using a clay brush and the move and something else, the inflate. So I'm going to jump into this slash brush. Slash brush is like basically like a little knife. It's going to allow me to cut into my model. So I can create like little trails, like so. It's good for wrinkles, it's good for skin detail, whatever. But like I said, all these brushes, they're really, really high, so you have to bring intensity down some. And it's all pressure sensitive, so between intensity and amount of pressure you put onto the model. That's how deep you actually want to go into this model. So, yes.
So I'm actually new to ZBrush. One of the issues that I've been having with some of the brushes is, as you said, it's pressure sensitive and sometimes you can kind of lose the control. Do you have any recommendations for artists who are just kind of getting started with it? Like, do you have any recommendations or tips to help maintain that control? As you're getting training with the brush itself or training with the tool.
What version of ZBrush do you have?
The most recent.
All right, so do I. So I'm working in R8 now, which is basically ZBrush 4 release 8. What most people don't know is that by default, I don't know if you can see it, but see up on here where it's there's a little numbers where you can draw the draw size here?
Yes, sir.
All right, there's a little word that says dynamic. That's always on by default, because it thinks that you want to use a dynamic brush, which is what I'm doing. I'm using dynamic clay. But if you hold the shift button down and you click on it, you can turn that off. Right now it's on, turn it off. It's going to give you a better state of control. Now you're still going to need to increase or decrease your intensity, but that's really on you. So I can come in and I can go as light as I want to, or I can go deeper if I want to.
So the turning off the dynamic takes out the pressure control?
It takes out, it doesn't take to turn it off, it just
makes it a little bit easier to work with.
Right.
Okay.
And then you can have more control by using intensity here. So you know, and it all depends on which brush you use, because each brush has its own level of intensity.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
Use
the
tablet?
I'll say yes.
Yes, I recently started working with the actual like display tablets, okay. And I'm used to, you know, mouse and, you know, that more kind of, you know, vertice control, and so making that switch and try, like, it's that, you know, it's getting there, but sometimes it's like, and then.
Yeah, it does take some getting used to a tablet. The really nice thing is, because of the sensitivity of the tablet versus a mouse,
yeah.
You the harder you press, the more it's going to kind of sculpt.
Yeah.
So once you start getting used to that, you kind of realize that like a little light stroke is going to give you a light sort of contour or sculpt, and then the harder you press, it's going to, you know, obviously get to a point, but that's going to give you more, you know, kind of a deeper gouge or a lighter gouge depending on that pressure sensitivity. So it does take some getting used to though.
It's that physical part of being an artist where like actually going to the gym sometimes is actually a really good idea.
Right, right, right. It's
like, why are you lifting so much? So I can control my
hand.
Right.
You're doing all these little exercises.
Yeah, it's like, what are you doing? Beefing
exercising.
Up. Need a bulk.
Yeah.
Let's mask off this face. I don't like the shape. I'm going to invert that mask. Brush sides down. So whatever you do inside the ZBrush, you can always adjust things. Like I have this kind of, whatever you want to call this, face and mouth thing here.
The upper mouth?
Yeah, whatever. So let's say if I want to move that up, you can always come in and just adjust it. Once I do that, I'm still going to come back in here, maybe possibly re-sculpt the information.
Facial features, which side do you think he should sculpt? Left one, left side of the face or right side of the face? Which side should he sculpt?
Hello, teaching lesson. Whatever it is, I'm doing it wrong.
Maybe you are.
What's the answer?
His right side. Do you know why he should sculpt on his left side? Because
he has
eyeballs. Oh, yeah.
So that he can sculpt more accurately.
Other side, he doesn't have eyeballs.
Symmetry is everything.
Yeah.
Well, I build up in symmetry. I would say once you get to a closer to a finalized model, then you make it asymmetric. I would always say that, but you know, to start off, never start off in asymmetric, because you can't control it. You're going to sculpt this side, and you go ahead and sculpt this side. Versus if you're going to have a character with one arm, sculpt both arms out in detail, and then when it's all done, chop off the other arm, and then you go from there. It makes life a lot easier.
Process
and
then achieve
the
higher quality.
You guys have any other questions?
No questions? All right, there you go.
So you really wanted to respond to that?
Yeah.
Do I have questions? What do you think?
Katie, you want to give another clip?
Maybe I can come up with something.
Okay.
Here's a quiz. What's my name? You can't answer.
You can't.
There you go. Here's a quiz. What's his name?
Did we even introduce or we just started?
I don't know. I think we just started off.
I think you introduced yourself.
Did I?
Did
we? Did I introduce myself? Not really?
Well, like the panel description. Let's see. What does it say about us? Oh.
Hello. My name is Daryl. This is my brother Larry. This is my other brother Larry. You guys, you don't know that show.
Sorry. We're identical twins.
Huh?
Said we're identical twins. We've had a lot of surgery.
There's actually an old show called New Heart. And I hate to say this, but I was watching it the other day.
So, am I gonna?
Yeah.
Yes.
So, I've always really been fascinated with the detailing, like what you're doing, like with the skin and the wrinkles in the neck and things like that. And, you know, I've been cheating a lot of the time. I just, you know, I project an image and then kind of, you know, use that. But
who says that's cheating?
It's a good cheating.
Well, it gets it done. But
yeah.
I've always wanted to talk to somebody who, as you proficient as you are, of how do you kind of like, without using reference, without, or as in, like, sorry, I'll simplify the question. How do you approach something like that to kind of maintain the realism? Like, and I know that you've probably done it 1,000 times, and I imagine that's part of the answer, but how do you kind of mentally approach it and just kind of get started with it?
I always use references. This is probably one of the only times that I'm not, because the model's already done. With me, and I'll be honest, I have the hardest time coming up with this stuff at the top of my head. It takes me a lot longer to do it. I mean, I think the first model that I did, this isn't even the first model. I did 3 other models before I said I'm gonna demo this one. And I didn't like any of them, because I do that a lot, because I come up with it at the top of my head. But if I had a concept artist who would give me a drawing, say, hey, do this, then I'll do it. And it doesn't take me a long time. What was your question? I'm sorry.
You're answering my question.
Okay.
And I actually have the same thing. Anytime I try to do, like, I always have a really great idea in my head, but anytime I try to do it out of my head where it's not on some kind of piece of paper where it's been predetermined, I just can't get it to go.
I'll say this. I like to build creatures and characters.
Exactly.
And I can do humans. I actually have a robot female on my website. Where is she? I can do humans, but they're boring to me, and I'd rather do some kind of a creature or something like that. But if I can build a nice concept, a nice creature, somebody give me some really detailed artwork, I can build it in no time because I don't have to think about it. This way, I have to think about what I'm doing and where I'm going. But it always falls short of doing a really good creature. They always end up looking humanoid or biped. But I like to do more dragons, but dragons have been done so many times. I like to do more aliens, but all my aliens, they still look humanoid. So I like to get away from that to do something totally different. But it's hard without concept.
And honestly, 3D sculpting tools such as ZBrush, it's probably better for concept art than doing concept art on 2D paper, because some of us have like a more 3D mind than 2D mind. I have a hard time coming up with the mech type concept design, because I can get this perspective, but I cannot imagine what's going on around behind the front side and stuff. So if we have a 3D software like this, ZBrush, it's easier for me to do that concept art. So I'm doing concept art more on 3D than 2D.
I'm more a 3D artist than 2D, and I partnered up with a number of illustrators that I adore their work, and we collaborate back and forth. Very similar to you, where it's like I love doing creatures and characters, and anytime I see a character that just kind of speaks to me in that way of. I basically supplement my kind of lack of this or that, but I also have that same kind of thing when it comes to mechanical things of like I like to like put the box and the cylinder and things like that just around here, and then I make it look pretty later after I figure out how it works. And I actually recently just did a project where, you know, for study, where it was like this wrist gauntlet thingy, and I'm like, okay, I want it to do this, but like, how is it mechanically going to do this? And then the fun part was realizing after the mechanic part got worked out, the rest of it just kind of fell into place. And so I'm right there with you.
All right, so I'm gonna jump for another 3 hours. I have a little bit more detail into the model. I might start adding, I'll probably start smoothing out some of these, some of the heavy lines a little bit so that it will kind of blend in a little bit better. I think I have my smooth on too high. Yes.
How do you make it good?
Like animate when it's done?
Yeah.
Different program.
Oh, okay.
So that's once this is done, yeah, I will send this out to another program like Maya or 3D Studio Max, something like that. And I'll put what we call bones, we rig it up, and then that will allow us to actually move the information.
Oh, okay.
You're at Sac State, right?
Yeah.
Oh, well, I can't say this on
you can actually pose them in ZBrush without having too much null of rigging or making a move. But actually doing the animation, you have to use it. You have to bring this out of here into another program to get that to do.
You actually answered it, but at the same, so with posing it, do you, from ZBrush, does it take care of the weight mapping kind of issue inside itself? I apologize, simplify the question. When you're posing it, do you have to do a lot of cleanup work?
Well,
so at a certain level you do.
Depends on your cleanup. So let's say if I wanted to actually pose this. Now, the cool thing about ZBrush, and I didn't know this until this summer, and I still haven't told my student. It's funny. There's ZBrush has what they call a transpose tool. It allows us to go in and we'll have to mask out parts of our model. So if I want to, and I'm gonna turn off this eyeball so that I can really mess this up. And then when I'm done, I'll jump right into that final detail scope again. But if I wanna, let's say if I wanna pose this, and right now it's in the auto save, it's gonna take a little while. If I wanna pose this, I can go ahead and create a mask. And then I use the transpose tool to kind of remove model from one way, the other, or whichever angle or direction I need to, and then I have to go back in to kind of sculpt in the difference or the detail. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
It's a little bit more work, but you know, you figure out where the thing, how the muscle should work. So that's why anatomy book come in really handy. So you see the ones that show you different poses, how the muscle move in the neck, body, the arm, or whatever. And use that as a reference to kind of re-scope or reposition your geometry on your mesh. Does that help?
Yes, sir.
Sounds right?
Help me.
Thank
you. As soon as I touch this, I'm just wasting time now because lack of memory. It's good to say. Better watch me now.
Are you interested in animation?
Yeah, I mess around on this computer.
Okay.
So it's really him, but it's just really interesting.
Yeah. I'm more on the animation side. I like to model, but he is probably twice the time, I'd be twice the time that he would take. Because I know it's something how my brain is set up. It's like, oh, this is all great for me, so I'm fiddling with all these little tiny things instead of, you know, kind of going, just kind of like, oh, that works. I don't know. It's the only way that I can interpret it. But I find that a lot of people who animate were control freaks. We really want that control. Like, otherwise I'd be making films with live action actors. But I can't control them. So I like to animate characters that I can kind of completely control. So, yeah.
So what programs for
animation? I use Maya, and mainly because that's every place I went, they were using Maya, so I learned a lot of it. I I started off using a program called Lightwave, but I started using that as just sort of a side thing when I was going to school first. It was part of what was called Video Toaster, and started using it way back when. And then I got my first sort of real animation job. I got based on sending a demo reel, and got the job, and then learned after I was hired that they're using Maya. And I had to point out to them that I don't know that. I said, oh, you'll learn. Like, okay. But, you know, really, if you know how to use one, you can kind of apply that, like control keys, like knowing the keys and knowing where all the functions are. You got to figure all that out, like knowing the interface, but just kind of understanding how it works in general. It's a transferable skill. You can learn something else because you know, because I know Maya so well, I could probably learn Blender. It's all there, but I'd have to figure out where things are.
So, but if you wanted to pose this, now this is going to look ridiculous because I haven't actually blurred this out enough. So I have to blur the mask so I can control it a little bit better. But I can lock and unlock the gimbal so I can move this up and down. And I can lock it back and just rotate this. So I'm getting a portion of the head rotated and I can move it back. So this would be kind of like my attempt to start posing them all.
And you can fade out that mask too a little bit too, right? You can. It doesn't have to be such a harsh line, right?
It doesn't. That's why I was doing the blur, but because this detail is so heavy, it's only doing a very, very small amount. In order for this to work, I need to turn off my symmetry as well. So that's the problem. It's bending basically on both sides. So as I move it, it's moving both sides of my model symmetrically. So once I turn that off, now if I rotate it, it's going to get some weird results, but it's not as bad. There you go. And let's move it back in place. And then from here, I need to go back in and resculpt out this information. I can try to smooth it down because the geometry is so heavy, and I'm just using DynaMesh. It's gonna take a lot more for me to pose, but that'll be something like at the end, not in the stages where I'm doing this right now. So once I have this done, just check. I think I need to show you that the final, which I had before. So this would be my final model, or actually my final concept. So if I want to get us to a director or something like that, then they'll have something that can go off from. They'll say, yeah, we want to keep this, or maybe no, change this or change that. But the point is, concepts need to be done fairly quick. But it all depends on what you're working on and how much time you have. Sometimes they needed that by the end of the day, maybe by the end of the week. Any questions? No? I don't know if there's somebody after us, isn't there?
There is. There's at 3:45 is the next one. So. We have about 5 minutes. Well, 5 minutes. They're going to start 7.
And if I want to get this out to art director, I'll give him maybe something like this, or maybe I'll have it in a certain perspective, and I have a side shot, front shot. Then you can decide if I need to make any changes or something like 3/4, I'm sorry. Then you'll make the decision on where we need to go from here. Whether he likes it, trash it, or make improvements somewhere. Make sense? Any questions? No?
I really love the cranial cavity.
Oh,
just that amazing, subtle, but powerful work.
Well, thank you. All right.
Well, if there's no other questions.
Cool. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you. Yeah, take care.